China and India. Together they consume roughly the same amount of oil as all of Europe. And why wouldn't they? Demographics would have it no other way. With their billion-plus populations, growing middle class, and rapid urbanization comes strong economic growth. And that brings, in tow, rising oil demand. But the similarities seem to have ended there, at least this year. For the first 7 months of 2014, Chinese oil demand growth was almost flat compared with a year ago, while Indian consumption climbed nearly 2%. But both economies are facing headwinds. Look behind the headline figures and you see a lot of interesting shifts taking place in terms of individual oil product demand, refining capacity utilization, imports and exports. What are these shifts and why should we care? Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. I'm Vandana Hari and I'm joined in our Singapore studio today by our China and India experts, Yen Ling Song and Mriganka Jaipuriyar. Welcome. Yen Ling, if I may start with you, Chinese oil demand, the second biggest oil consumer now in the world, next to the US, about 10 million barrels per day of apparent oil demand. But in the first 7 months of this year, nearly zero demand growth. Tell me, does that surprise you?
Actually, no, because if you look at the headline number, everybody knows now that China's GDP growth has gone under 8% for the last 2 years. In the first quarter of this year, it was 7.4%, just a little under the government's full-year forecast of 7.5%. And what we saw in oil demand was actually a contraction in the first quarter, so close to 1% negative growth.
Wow. And for the full year, the GDP might not even meet the government's target of 7.5%.
Yes. Some analysts obviously are a bit more bearish in terms of their forecasts, but usually it tends to work out in such a way that, you know, the economy does indeed meet the government's forecast, which already some may say is quite conservative.
Yeah. But there's also talk of China's oil intensity. So in the previous years, even 7% GDP growth would have brought about a little more oil demand growth in the country, isn't it?
But this is the first time that we've seen under 8%. So previously when we had double-digit oil demand growth, that was like 9%, 10%, 11% in GDP growth. So this is, I think, the first time in sort of like the last few decades that we've actually seen economic growth slow to such a level. And what we've seen basically in terms of the oil demand is that, you know, certain products have been significantly hit.
Okay, so it's not across the barrel. You're seeing some differences between in the individual product demand.
Mm.
Okay, how does that look, gas oil and gasoline especially?
So the one that has been affected the most basically is gas oil. 4 years ago, we saw gas oil demand growing at double digit. When economic growth was over 8%, and now we see actually a contraction in gas oil demand, and that's basically because industrial activity has fallen off.
Yeah,
manufacturing activity has slowed down as well.
Right, we'll come back to that. Mriganka, the 2% growth in India. Now I know Indian economy is also not doing as well as, and maybe now it might again with the Modi government. One doesn't really know, but what in your view explains the 2% growth in Indian demand?
Unlike in China where GDP growth plays a big role, in India, of course, the economy and economic growth does play a role, but Indian oil demand for specific products is often quite skewed and distorted because of the government subsidy policy. Oil demand in the first 7 months of this year has grown by about a little under 2.5%, and this has mainly been led by gasoline and LPG, and the subsidy policy does come in over there.
Yeah.
Diesel demand had actually been contracting for the last 18 months. Over the last 2 or 3 months, we've seen a recovery in diesel demand, though prices are getting higher and closer to being deregulated. Mm. And that can be explained by economic factors. You're seeing
a
jump
to China
in. Yes. Yeah. So now what analysts are saying is, we can consider 2014 to be like a base year. Mm. Once, should the government fully deregulate diesel, gasoline is at market prices. So now we can start looking at 2014 as a base year from which supply and demand factors years will start to play a role.
Right. So now diesel demand should actually move along with the prices, market determined prices.
And I guess prices would more reflect supply and demand,
right,
as opposed to, you know, just people switching from gasoline-driven cars to gas-oil-driven cars because
yes,
gas-oil prices are regulated.
Yes, right. Now, in India, deregulation has been a big story. Fuel subsidies and the losses incurred by the refiners,
yeah,
oil marketing companies,
yes,
has been at the forefront as well. How do you think the oil marketing companies are now doing with the gas-oil nearly deregulated?
Yeah, well, gas-oil, the under-recoveries on diesel have fallen. Under-recoveries, which is basically losses from selling fuel at government-regulated prices, have basically fallen to you know, almost they're almost nothing right now. So with that, their under recoveries on diesel have been coming down. Of course, they're still suffering on LPG and kerosene.
So those are still heavily subsidized.
Those are still heavily subsidized. But what we are also seeing is, I mean, gas oil was the biggest chunk because it accounts for close to 40% of India's total oil demand.
Sure.
So if gas oil does get fully deregulated, you will find their overall under recoveries falling. But a more interesting thing that I spotted was, you know, the Indian government, I think for the first time, has actually reimbursed state-owned oil marketing companies in the first quarter of the fiscal year, which is the April-June quarter, which has helped them with their liquidity situation. Normally what would happen is the government would reimburse them towards the end of the year.
Right.
So
and they have
had
to keep borrowing in the external markets.
Yes, so they would have heavy interest cost payments. They would have to rely on short-term borrowings.
Mm-hmm.
But now with the payments coming in on time, their liquidity has improved. And if this this continues, they will at least be in a better liquidity position. And, you know, that with if gas oil does get deregulated, they will probably have to compete with the likes of Reliance and SR in the retail space.
Of course.
So having ample liquidity will definitely hold them in good stead.
And make them more competitive as
yes,
well.
Yes.
Okay. Yen Ling, I was looking at some car sales figures this morning, and the August car sales, passenger vehicle sales in China, were up about 8.5% year on year, about 1.47 million vehicles sold in August alone. And even though that's a little bit of a smaller growth rate compared to the previous 7 months, which was about 11%, but nonetheless, I think the story remains that China is adding a lot of fleet onto its roads. So does that explain the sudden growth in gasoline demand?
Yes. So basically, gasoline is used primarily in the transport sector, and that's all passenger vehicles. Double-digit growth every year in car sales. There are over 200 million vehicles now on the roads. And China is the world's largest automobile market, basically.
Yeah.
And that explains what's happening in the gasoline space.
Mm-hmm.
So we have gasoline demand growing at 10% year on year so far. If you contrast that with gas oil, I mean, gas oil is, 60% used in the transport sector, and a lot of that is for heavy trucks, which transport goods and raw materials, and which that sector has been affected as well with the slowdown in economic growth.
Sure.
And then
the buying of cars doesn't seem to be impacted. Is that what is meant by shifting from an industrial to a consumer-driven economy?
Yes. So a lot of people have, disposable incomes that are growing, and there's a lot of urbanization happening in the third-tier, fourth-tier cities, further away from the coast.
Yeah, because there's no space, it seems, sometimes to add cars to
major roads,
right?
If you look at the amount of congestion on the major cities, it seems that, and they do actually have quota systems for the cars as well.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of the growth is coming from, inside China, so in areas that are away from the coastal cities. Basically just a lot of cars being on the roads has given rise to increased gasoline demand.
Yeah. So the shifting patterns, less gas oil demand, more gasoline demand, and I think more jet fuel demand as well. Is that putting pressure on the Chinese refiners to try and adapt their product slate?
Yes. In the last 2 years, the domestic refiners have actually been trying to curb their gas oil output and boost gasoline output as well as jet kerosene output.
To the extent it's possible,
I suppose,
not completely.
Yeah, because the traditionally geared towards producing the most gas oil.
Right.
So it's unlike in other markets such as the US where they have a lot of gasoline production.
Yes.
In China, it's a lot of gas oil. And that's because, mm-hmm. you know, gas oil is the largest among all the oil product demand. Mm-hmm. And it remains so, but, you know, gasoline demand is catching up. So now gasoline demand is about 25% of overall oil demand, when 4 years ago in 2010, it was 20%.
Yeah.
And then that for gas oil now is currently about 34%. Previously, mm-hmm. it was like over 36%.
Okay, so it seems like whatever wherever gas oil is giving way, gasoline is taking over. But China overall is also adding a lot of refining capacity. And we know that there are restrictions on how much they can export, unlike India, mm. where all the surplus can be exported, but not so in China. You have to take government permission.
Yes.
And you get quotas on how much you may export. So are the refiners being able to utilize all of the new capacity they have?
They have recognized that, you know, they are basically facing a serious overcapacity in the sector right now because of what's happening with oil demand. And what they've done is basically taken steps to curb the expansion as well. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the new projects that were announced 2 years ago, they basically said, okay, let's delay this, you know, and then anything that was supposed to come on in 2015, 2016, we've seen about 1 to 2 year delays to new projects. And then with the existing refineries, expansion projects have also slowed down. Such that now the focus is on upgrading to produce low sulfur fuels rather than expanding units.
Okay, and that's more for environmental consciousness
that's
within
right.
the country
that's
itself.
Right. Because obviously pollution is now a big issue in China. The
yes,
government
it certainly
wants that,
is.
Yeah, you know.
Yes.
So what's happened with the export side, as you said, they do have product quotas, so they do have to request from the government let's say I want to export so much products this month, they do have to seek permission from the government. But interestingly, this year, all their requests actually have been approved. So
okay.
the quotas that they've been given actually are higher than what they've exported so far. So there is actually more room for exports to come you know, in the next quarter or so.
So we can expect to see growing exports from China in the coming
yes.
years?
Yes. Growing exports, I guess that is the intention if they are facing overcapacity at home, because they don't want to go below, let's say, 80% utilization in the state-owned refineries.
Sure. So talking of utilization rates, Mriganka, yeah. in India, it's always been above 100% for as
yes.
long as I can remember. And the country is also adding refining capacity, though not as much as China, but nonetheless, there's more capacity coming up. So what's the refining landscape looking like in India?
Yeah. India is adding capacity, but at a much slower pace than China. Current capacity is about 4.4 million barrels per day. Mm-hmm. The biggest project to come on stream in the near future is IOC's Paradeep refinery, which has a capacity of 300,000 barrels per day. But other than that, there is no big greenfield refinery slated to come on stream. You've got some brownfield expansions, debottlenecking. So, you know, according to analyst estimates and our own research, capacity is going to go up by about 500,000 barrels per day over the next, say, 3 to 4 years.
So would you say it would just about keep pace with domestic
yes,
demand growth?
Yes, it would just about keep pace with domestic demand growth and allow exports as well. Because, you know, domestic demand is right now about 3.5 million barrels per day. Mm-hmm. Analysts expect demand to go up by about 120,000 to 150,000 barrels per day each year going forward for the next few years.
Right.
So we would continue to see exports out of the Indian market. But right now, the exports are dominated by the private refiners,
yes,
Reliance
and
SR.
Right.
Once India should India fully deregulate mm-hmm. gas oil prices, you know, these refiners may want to start entering the retail sector.
Do you expect to see competition in the retail sector between the private
yes,
and the state-owned
yes,
refiners?
Yes, there will be competition, and you know, given how complex Reliance and SR's refineries are,
yeah.
they enjoy significantly better refining margins
yeah.
than the state-owned
and
refiners.
So better quality products,
better
as
quality
well,
products, higher refining margins. So they are better placed than the state-owned
to be more
refiners.
More competitive.
So
okay.
it you know. Indian government and state-owned refiners have already started talking about what they should do to to retain their market share. I mean, this is still a little bit in the future, but they have already started thinking about it.
Otherwise, they'll have to look towards the export markets, which are not easy either today.
No, they aren't, because all the new refineries coming up in the region, in the Middle East, and you know, they're all high complex refineries which produce higher quality fuels. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens in the Indian refining and retail sector once gas oil is deregulated. Would Reliance and SR bother entering the retail market? Are they happy to just, you know, have a chunk of the export market? So it's interesting times ahead, I
think, in India. And challenging times as well for both China and India. Thank you very much for joining me today, Yen Ling and Mriganka.
Thank you.
We hope you found this informative, and do join us again for the next edition of Platts Commodity Pulse. Thank you.